From WRTI, welcome to The Late Set. I'm Greg Bryant.
And I'm Nate Chenin.
John Coltrane, that's what we were listening to there. But another Coltrane brought us together about 3 years ago.
Just after you moved to the New York metro area to become a DJ on the air, I invited you out to hear some music. And we went to the Jazz Standard in Manhattan and saw the Ravi Coltrane Quartet. It had ourselves some ribs,
yeah.
a little mac and cheese, and started a conversation. By the end of the night, I think both of us were like, man, we should keep this energy going. Yeah. We got a lot to talk about. It was not long after that that the world entered a kind of pause and we found ourselves kind of locked down and in place. I started thinking, you know what? I think there's a way that we could keep this conversation going and yeah. let some others eavesdrop on it.
That's right. Yeah, we came together in another, you know, podcast effort that was really successful for both of us and for the musical community. We were talking about things like, you know, racial equity and creativity, you know, within this lockdown. But I'm really happy that we've launched this new effort. It's a new show. It's The Late Set. And for the first time, I'm actually in a room with you on dual microphones. How about that?
That's right. It's worth saying. Our previous show was called Jazz United.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you are here because you know that show. For the entirety of its two seasons, Jazz United was created in remote circumstances. Greg and I were taping in our respective homes and
our respective closets.
Yeah,
folks.
That's right. Bedroom closets, yeah. Pandemic style.
Yeah.
We now find ourselves in different circumstances, thankfully, and in a different city.
That's right.
So here we are, both of us sitting in a studio at WRTI on North Broad Street.
Yeah.
On the campus of Temple University in Philadelphia. That is actually the subject of this first episode of The Late Set. We want to also mention that The Late Set, we welcome friends and special guests to pass through. And on today's episode, we will shortly be hearing from the eminent Philadelphia pianist, composer, bandleader, scene maker, Orrin Evans.
That's right. Mayor Evans, as I like to call him. He knows the scene. He knows Philadelphia. And it's just that kind of conversation, folks. You know, what happens after, you know, the band is already warmed up. It's the last set of the night. We want to give that kind of vibe and atmosphere and stretch out in some meaningful conversations about our Philadelphia scene and beyond. And speaking of Philadelphia, this is actually your second time here.
This is true.
And I want to let the people know, Nate Chenin is a native of Honolulu, Hawaii. And I've asked myself for years, why leave beautiful Honolulu? Why Philly, man? What happened?
Oh, Greg, haven't you ever seen a sunset over the Schuylkill? There's nothing like it.
Okay.
Well, I am glad you asked because I came to Philly for college in 1994. And I fell into the scene here and really just fell in love with the jazz community in this city.
Yeah.
For all the things that are great about Hawaii, it doesn't have the kind of jazz lineage and legacy that Philadelphia has, right? And the beautiful thing about it, I owe so much to this city for those reasons, right? I was an aspiring musician when I came here. I got a ton of experience playing on the scene here, but probably more importantly, this is the city where I became a journalist. I became a critic. And it happened because of a bygone institution called the Philadelphia City Paper, where I started as an unpaid intern and, you know, gradually became the senior jazz critic in my early 20s and really had to learn by doing, you know, learned on the job, made a bunch of mistakes, but more importantly, understood the craft and also understood that when you write something and it goes out and it's read by the public and then you go out to the club and the musicians are there, they will let you know if you are off base, you know? And if your take is not correct, you have to be able to defend it.
Yeah.
If you can defend it, you're cool. But if it's indefensible, well, then maybe you've learned a lesson there, young man. Anyway, this city was both challenging and nurturing for me. And I think that that's actually the key to understanding the Philly jazz scene, is that it is supportive, but it's also like a crucible. You really have to come correct. And I think that lesson is, it's being learned by successive generations. But Greg, I got to tell you one story that illustrates this.
Please.
When I first arrived here, I guess I was 17, and on my very first night in town, the concierge at the hotel where my parents and I were staying before freshmen move in, we said, "Hey, where can we hear some jazz?" And you know, the guy said, "Oh, there's a really good club just, you know, a few blocks from here," and he directed us to Zanzibar Blue. Before it was on Broad Street, it was I think on 12th Street.
Yeah.
And so we went to Zanzibar Blue without knowing who was playing. It was a piano trio, and I was just young and brash enough to ask during the set break, "Hey, do you mind if I sit in?"
Yeah.
And they actually allowed me to sit in, I think a little skeptically.
Mm-hmm.
But I did okay. I did okay enough that the drummer actually said, "Hey, you're new in town. You know, you need to understand the lay of the land.
Right.
You know, let me take you around." And so this drummer, whose name was Pete Vinson.
What?
Pete Vinson. Yeah, you know him?
Oh, man. Continue. I'm coming back to
okay.
that.
Okay. All right. So Pete, he actually showed up on the corner near my freshman dorm the following Monday, pulled up in his Buick, picked me up, and he said, "All right, we're going to go hit the jam sessions." Pete hadn't been a jam session guy for a few years. He drove me over to Ortlieb's first, which was closed on Monday night. And so plan B, we went to a place called the Blue Moon. We walk in, and there's a young cat on piano wearing a baseball cap, and just he was demolishing. And that was my first experience encountering Orrin Evans.
Whoa. Okay.
And so,
crazy,
you know,
man.
But I raise that story because it is so illustrative of the generosity that I encountered on the scene, you know. And this was true at Ortlieb's and at Chris's, you know, places where I used to sit in all the time.
Yeah.
And get the support of people like Byron Landham, you know, and Mike Boone.
Yeah.
You had to prove yourself. You had to show that you were bringing something. But once you did, then, you know, you did have a hand up. And Pete Vinson showed, I mean, there's nothing in it for him. He was just doing a good deed. And wow. And I never forgot that.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I can tell that story is just, you know, a glowing representation of the folklore that I've heard about this city that I experienced first, though, on record. You'll hear me, folks, go back to my Fisher-Price turntable days throughout this podcast, okay? Imagine this three-year-old kid in his parents' record collection. One of those records was Grover Washington Jr. live at the Bijou. And when you said Pete Vinson, I lit up for joy because he and bassist Tyrone Brown, that's my musical DNA. That's my start. That's how I understand the bass and drums rhythm connection, you know, at a very young age. Philadelphia was the sound of that record for me, honestly. An exciting crowd, musicians who were well-versed in groove, they could swing their butts off, and they also had this fiery nod to almost some avant leanings, but it was all okay. It was all acceptable.
Music for the people.
You know what I mean?
Greg, I think we need to drop the needle on Lock It
Let's
in
get
the
to
Pocket.
It now. Let's get to it.
Here we go. That was Lock It in the Pocket from the Grover Washington Jr. album Live at the Bijou with my man Pete Vinson on drums.
Yes, it was. Oh, my goodness.
So yeah, let's talk about your relationship with Philadelphia because, you know, as you said, this is my second time around.
Mm-hmm.
You've been here for a little over a year now.
Yeah.
You were in the New York area.
Right.
And before that, your hometown of Nashville.
True.
So what is the nature of your relationship with Philly and with the jazz scene here? I mean, did you come with some preconceived notions or like a prior relationship other than our man Grover?
Sure. I think in general, I see it as a city with a spirit, a strong city spirit, very unlike the city that I came from that you mentioned, which is Nashville, Tennessee. I really resonated with the East Coast vibrations, though, as a young child, everybody minding their own business, but in search of the best that they could be. That was my ethos of what the East Coast meant. So I was trying to get to the East Coast as fast as I could. At first, it was as a touring musician. I came to Philadelphia to play World Cafe Live and the Ardmore and got to see some of the jam sessions that you were talking about, but never really participate because we were on a tight schedule.
Yeah.
But I always thought that Philadelphia, as you said, was a proving ground, but that also was a self-contained community. There's people like Bootsy Barnes and Larry McKenna that never really left Philadelphia. But even as a Nashvillian in search of, you know, beyond the, you know, A-list names in jazz, I knew who they were.
Yeah.
So Philadelphia certainly had the space to tell it, if you will, about their talent. But I also saw a city that maybe was a little bit chip on its shoulder, if I could say it that way, about being so close to New York, but by not being seen as the top-tiered talent base that it really is.
Yeah, well, that's a really good point because there are moments in jazz history where you see the Philadelphia sound or Philadelphia style, if you will, moving in and taking over, you know? And I'm thinking about the first so-called great Miles Davis quintet with Philly Joe Jones and John Coltrane and Red Garland, you know?
Yeah.
Philly Joe really is the guy who assembled that band, more or less.
That's right.
And it's a Philly band, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Or the, you know, almost contemporaneous edition of Art Blakey's Jazz Messengers, you know, the Bobby Timmons, Benny Golson band, you know, which is, let's call Blakey an honorary Philadelphian during that tenure. He's from Pittsburgh, but, you know, everyone else in that band was Philly.
That's right. That's right.
And so, you know, you think of these moments where the Philly sound is the dominant sound, but it's always coexisting with this idea that New York is the Mecca, right? It's like, you've got to go to New York, you got to make it in New York. But, you know, we opened this show with a recording of John Coltrane at the Showboat for a reason.
That's right. Right.
Because Coltrane, during his, you know, really the peak of his band leading experience, you know, in 1963, 64.
Yeah.
That band was world class.
Right.
They played, they came back and they played the Showboat a lot.
Yeah.
You know, if you look at the, at the you know, Coltrane's road diary.
Yep.
You know, they never got too big for Philly.
Not at all. Not at all. And I think that's indicative of the fans here. In another world or another analogy, Philadelphia sports fans are some of the most rowdy, defensive, aggressive sports fans, which reminds me, the old DJ and record producer Joel Dorn talks about being outside of the Showboat that we're talking about. And there's this fist fight going on in the street. And he leans over and asks a guy, "Hey, man, what are they fighting about? Is it a girl? Is it, you know, some money?" "No, man. One guy says Sonny Rollins is greater. The other guy says John Coltrane is greater." So it's that kind of environment that still seeps through the generations that I find myself encountering here as host of Evening Jazz. Notably, I stand on the shoulders of a great man, BP, Bob Perkins. And as much as I admire that classic landscape, you, Nate, and I have partnered with you in this. We want to make sure to attach Philadelphia, not just to classic things, but to now.
That's right.
And I know we have to move the needle and there is some opposition. I'll just go ahead and tell it. But I'm glad to be here. And I hope that we can help this generation of Philadelphia as a music society be a healthy embrace of ancient to the future.
Yeah, that's beautifully put. And, you know, if you have been listening to WRTI for a long time, you know BP with the GM.
Yep.
GM, for those who don't know, stands for good music.
Yep.
But you know what? The good music is not a static thing.
That's right.
And that's what Mr. Bryant here is reminding us of. That's what I believe firmly with all my heart. The music evolves.
That's right.
We don't discard the old.
No, no.
We carry it forward. And you know what? So does our guest in this episode. He is a perfect example of that bridge. And so with that, why don't we pivot to our conversation with the great Orrin Evans.
Mm-hmm.
We are pleased to welcome Orrin Evans to the late set. And Nate, I think you have a bit of an Orrin Evans story.
Well, I'll tell you this. Earlier I alluded to the fact that on my first night in town in Philadelphia, I sat in at Zanzibar Blue, and the drummer on that gig was Pete Vinson. And he liked what he heard enough that he said, you know what, I'm going to take you around and show you the spots. You know, you need to know the lay of the land. So he picked me up, you know, the next week, and we drove around. I think Ortlieb's was closed that night. And so he said, I've heard of this other spot. So we rolled up to the Blue Moon Jazz Cafe, and there was somebody at the piano who was like, not that much older than me, wearing like a t-shirt and a baseball cap and just demolishing. And I remember Pete looked at me, he was like, I thought I knew everybody. And that was my introduction to Orrin Evans. And what a fortuitous one. And here we are. So thank you, first of all, for being here.
Thank you. Pete was amazing. We ended up playing together a little bit after that at the old Zanzibar. Mm-hmm. When I say old, the 11th Street Zanzibar. Yeah. And there was just music almost 7 days, you know, and it's ironic that you said Ortlieb's was closed that night because Ortlieb's was only closed on Mondays.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So that's why Blue Moon did their jam session on Mondays. And that's where I started. So it was like all these different things, but there was always somewhere to go.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That was my experience too. You know, you think about the Tuesday Ortlieb's situation, which you've had a hand in trying to kind of resuscitate on the scene in Philly. So much happening at Ortlieb's. Chris's was fairly new at that point, or just getting started. And then places like Natalie's and Bob and Barbara's, and you know, it was kind of like everywhere.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Definitely. Oh man, Bob and Barbara's, Natalie's. I used to live on I used to live on 40th Street between Market and Chestnut. So Natalie's was right at the corner. And I could literally sit in my apartment and hear some of the Saturday matinees, you know, with some of the great people that I was able, blessed to just be around.
If I had to ask you, Orrin, for someone who may be listening now that's outside of Philadelphia, that maybe hasn't traversed the Philadelphia landscape, what is the Philadelphia sound to you?
You know, the beautiful thing is, for years, I probably would give you I would define that for you. Mm-hmm. For years, I would. I would say, well, this is the way that, you know, certain drummers play their ride cymbals. You know, I might have said that. Then I might have said, well, this is the way that a lot of piano players voice chords, because you could hear similarity in McCoy Tyner and Bobby Timmons. Mm-hmm. You could really hear similarities if you were really listening. You could hear similarities in the way that Trudy Pitts played, along with other people like Shirley Scott, as far as organ, and Joey DeFrancesco, you know, who after came along. But you can hear like the Philly thing. But then I got away from saying that, because then where does Jamaluddin Takuma fit into that?
Uh-huh.
Where does Dave Burrell fit into that? Where does Sun Ra fit into that? Although you can still hear some of those voicings. I mean, I think it's a piano thing. You can't get away from it. You can still hear some of those voicings in there. And even in Dave Burrell. The Philly sound is one that, if you're willing to embrace the diversity of sound, then you're willing to really deal with the Philly sound, because it goes from Catalyst to the Roots. It's just huge. And I mean, you know, no one's going to ask you about the Jersey sound. And I'm originally born and raised in Jersey. So I say that, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, when we talk about Hall & Oates and like just all the connection, that's right outside of Jersey, which really comes into Philly. And it's just from jazz, not only jazz, but jazz, folk music, pop music. I never realized, when I was asked that question 20 years ago, I thought I had to answer it.
Mm-hmm.
And 20 years later, I'm like, there's no way to define how vast the music is even if you look at the people that live here right now, you mm-hmm. know, somebody put on Facebook the other day, they posted two venues that existed in the 90s. And they said, have you ever played at such and such and such and such? And, you know, I'm a comment searcher. I'll sit there and look at the comments all yeah. day. I'm like, wow, yeah. that's deep. And what I noticed as I was looking at the comments, there was a list of people that had played at venue A mm-hmm. and a list of people that had played at venue B. And it just started making me think about how diverse this city is, that you could have spent a whole career at venue A and never been to venue B. Mm-hmm. Or when you deal with the fact that although everyone loves to talk about the comparison of Bootsy Barnes and Larry McKinnon, two tenor titans who came from the city, they didn't meet till the 80s.
Wow.
You know, and I've talked to both of them about that. And it's really deep when you think about it, because Bootsy Barnes was dealing with the Black Musicians Union and Larry was touring wherever he was doing. And they didn't really, when I say they didn't meet, because somebody's probably listening to this and be like, no, they did meet one time. But there's a great article. I think it came out right around the time they did this record on Crisscross. Mm-hmm. And they talk about it in that article, how they didn't meet till much later in life. So and when you think mm-hmm. about the Philly sound, it's a very diverse one that is sometimes too welcoming, mm-hmm. but a very uh-huh. welcoming sound that's like, hey, come on, let me see what you got to offer. Mm-hmm. And that's the communal spirit of the city that I love, you know, and at the same time, that's the same spirit that sometimes we need to like close the door.
Interesting. You know?
Well, elaborate on that a bit, because, you know, when I think about my relationship to this city, it's really formative. You know, this is where I became a journalist. It's where I first started writing about music. It's the first real jazz community that I had a relationship with. This was the same time that I was getting to know you. And one feature article that I remember writing for the Philadelphia City Paper 25 years ago or something, it was a profile of you with a subtext of your tensions with the scene, you know, mm-hmm. and the fact that you felt that you had not been supported the way that you needed to be. And there was no choice for you but to go to New York and to spend some time away from the scene that you love. So I think you remember that moment.
Oh, I definitely, yeah. I definitely remember that moment. Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess, and 25 years later, I think what I've realized is what I've felt, and I will always struggle to be a champion to fix, is our inability. When I say our, I say Philadelphia, although I have to say people listening from Jersey, I'm from Trenton, New Jersey, but my musical career and my musical life started in Philadelphia. But we are a community that has a problem looking in the mirror and saying, I'm okay with myself. Hmm. We always have to validate if Nicholas is listening, we are really what jazz is. We have to validate ourselves by something else. Sometimes we Philadelphians are like, we're only good if this other person likes us. You know, and I think that's our biggest fault sometimes as a community and a music, because it gets in the way of us being able to stand on our own two feet and say, man, Catalyst with Eddie Green was a great band.
Yeah.
We don't need anybody else. We don't need to say such and such also guest starred in that band to make it great. Pieces of a Dream is a great band, mm-hmm. period. The Roots, great. We don't need to say, but sometimes we get to that. And much like the music that I play, we get to that because we're like, nothing else is working. So, all right, let me throw this other thing that has nothing to do with me but might validate me. And that's what I struggle with in Philly sometimes, where you don't look in the mirror and realize our own worth. So I'm not saying that in a negative way, like looking down on Philly. I'm looking up. Mm. And saying I want all of them to look up. And that's always been an issue.
I want to ask the B part of that question, though, because a lot of people say, you know, when I go away from my home city and I am recognized, then I come back and I'm embraced. on a really micro level. I've experienced that from where I come from, which is Nashville, Tennessee. When you came back to Philadelphia, you had grown, obviously, but did you feel a bigger embrace with your style, with your personage on the scene?
Well, the funny thing is, much like when you look at some of the artists like Jamal Adine Dacuma, and there's others I can't, Tyrone Brown, and the list can go on, I never really left Philly.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe that's some of the issues. I mean, I left in 93, went to Rutgers University, then went to New York. But I was always here. I had, you know, even some of that time in New York, I was coming back doing Blue Moon weekly. I went to New York. We lived there. I met new friends, and I brought them back to Philly. Mm-hmm. Some of the first places I played with the people that I met in New York were Blue Moon and Zanzibar, because I didn't have gigs in New York. So I was like, I went to New York, I met the people that I wanted to play with, and then I'm like, hey, I got some gigs in Philadelphia, and I'm driving back down the turnpike. So in the same way, it's almost like I never really left the girl long enough for her to miss me.
I did.
You know?
Yeah.
You know, you were describing that sort of looking in the mirror metaphor, and that's a real sort of internal dialogue. What about the external part? I mean, the support from audience members and from members of the community. I mean, do you feel that there was a gap between the quality of the musicianship on the scene and the quality of the support from the public?
I'll speak to the public first. I mean, Philly, if we just deal with sports, Philly, we're some of the worst sports fans in the world. It's like, if you ain't an Eagles fan, you might get a divorce over that. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. If you're not like a Phillies fan, or the best place to get a hoagie, the best place to get a cheesesteak. We're really hardcore on what we believe in. I don't say believe, I hope we don't believe in those things, but that we hold true.
Yeah.
As far as the audience, which carries on into the musicians too, and just us as being from the city, and maybe this is other cities, but I'm talking about Philly now, we hold so true to what we know, sometimes not realizing that we're closing the door to what we don't know. And that affects us as artists on the bandstand, and it affects us as supporters of the music. You know, one of the things during the series that I've been doing at Solar Myth, you'd be surprised at how many musicians have come up to me and said, I've never been here. And I may have never come here, you know, because some of the programming didn't lean toward them, or they weren't booked there. You know, that's one of the things we have to get over as musicians. We only go out if the person calls us for the gig. And I think the reality is, one of the best things that I did when I moved back to Philly in 98, I told my wife I would limit my local gigs. And I'm glad I did that, because then it became something more of, I just want to support the venue. I'm not supporting the venue because they're giving me a gig. You know, I'm supporting the venue because it's a venue supporting the music. And that's what we have to get to. But sometimes it gets into, they don't call me, so I'm not going. Or they don't make the hoagies the way I like them, so I'm not going. You know? So one of the things with the audience and the musicians that are on the stage in Philly is just opening our hearts to something and minds to something that we're not familiar with. And that's what I experienced in it growing up in Philly. You would see Edgar Bateman and then see Mickey Roker. You know, you see Arthur Harper and see Jimmy Merritt. So many different things, and they would all just get together. I remember the first time I heard David Murray in Philly, I didn't have the words to articulate that he was different to me than Hank Mobley. You know, that's a bad, but whatever. Just the bottom line. It was just music.
Yeah.
I didn't get into this was this and this was this. You got your hoagies with extra mayo, cool. I like my hoagies with onions, cool. Whatever. I'm going to try your hoagie. I'm not going to eat it, you know. I'm saying I'm not going to not eat it is what I meant to say. That's what came out the wrong way.
It's all good. I'm glad you mentioned Edgar Bateman there, because the first time I actually got to hear him was on Blessed Ones. That was the first album of yours I actually heard. You could say, I guess, pre-Tar Baby kind of configuration. But on your records, it's almost like a family album, if I can use that phrase. talk about community, preserving community, and using your records to be kind of a portal to the Philadelphia scene.
I mean, growing up with the parents that I had, there was always just something happening, whether it was a poetry reading or a little concert in our living room or a rehearsal or just a cookout. It was always something happening in the house that I grew up in. And then we moved to Philly, the same thing happened. It was just always somebody at the house and we were doing something. So for me, sometimes those still moments, I feel like, oh, I need to call some people and tell them to come over. And that is what has created that spirit in me, you know, to just, you know, what I call the village and just be communal and fellowship with people and celebrate all of our differences. If we don't do that off the bandstand, it's really, for me, impossible to do it on the bandstand. So one of the things I do love about being in Philly, like this afternoon, I had lunch with Luke O'Reilly and Neil Podgorski, two piano players. And I was like, man, how often does this happen where you just pop in a bar and there's three piano players just sitting around having a conversation? And we're talking about all our next records and what we want to do, three piano players. And that's what I've always wanted to do on and off the bandstand. So when I look at those records like, you know, Blessed Ones and Continuing, there were, that was more about let's just get together. Yeah, I think I called Edgar Bateman the day before that record day. I was like, oh, I want to see if he can do it. And I remember picking him up and driving him to New York. I think Eric had only played with him once before, 2 weeks prior at Ortlieb's, you know. But I was like, let's do this, you know. So it was more family. And Edgar's son and I went to high school together. We've known each other since sixth grade. So there's always that definite family thing. And that's what's really important to me, like in creating that energy on the bandstand that can transfer off the bandstand.
You mentioned the village. Wasn't there a period of time when you were getting cats together at your home, not to play, but just to talk? Like this was a while back.
Wow. Yeah. I don't even know if it's still on YouTube, but it was actually about two different clubs. And some of the musicians were having issues with the club and everything. I might have been like early Facebook. And I just called everybody over to my house, including the club owners. And I called it Hot Dogs and Jazz. And we just like, I cooked some hot dogs in the crock pot. And we all just talked about our grievances as the musicians. Pete Souders was there. Rest in peace, Ron was there. Ron Talton from Chris's. Representing Chris's, it was really a great day, and it was just great. Artists and the owners giving their side, like, you know, Ron wasn't the owner, but he was the general manager at the time, giving his side, like, this is what it cost me to do this, and this is what you're asking for. And then Pete giving his side as also an artist and an owner. But those moments were really special, and I remember Jerome Jennings even drove down from New York to be there. It was a great time.
That's like a council of reconciliation in your backyard.
There you go. Hot dogs and jazz.
This is why you're such a crucial linchpin of this and any scene. My goodness. Can you speak to where the scene is at now on a musical and social level? Because Greg and I, having both moved to Philly within the last year or two, and for me it's, you know, 20 something years since I left, I'm really struck by a vibrancy out there, you know? And it seems like there's a lot of positive energy. What is your perspective on that? Do you feel the same way, or am I making that up?
That's such a setup. We were like, we're going to talk about how sunny it is, and this big-ass cloud comes in. I'm sorry, I'm going to pull that back. I don't feel that. And I'll just be real. I miss the old Philadelphia. And I don't say that as like an old bitter person. I'll be as clear as possible. At 6 p.m. on a Sunday, now that my oldest is 30 and my youngest is 25 and they don't live with me, and my wife, at 6 p.m. on a Sunday, I should be able to go out and hear some swinging stuff in Philly.
Yeah.
And there was a time when I could. at 6 p.m. on a Sunday, I could go down to Ortlieb's. Now, Mondays was always that day that maybe something wasn't happening. But even before that, on Mondays, I could go to Blue Note up in my neighborhood now in West Oak Lane, where Tony Williams was doing a session, saxophonist. And Tony Williams, up until maybe 2 years ago, you know, he's not doing well right now and sending prayers and love out to him. But up until about 2 years ago, kept a session going every Monday somewhere, you know, so that was happening. Tuesdays, everybody went down to Ortlieb's, and then there was another crew that went to, I want to say 21st Street. That was what it was called, 21st Street Cafe. We have these, it's so divided. I played here and I didn't play here. And I'm like, why didn't you play at both places? And it was a very interesting thing is looking at who had played at both places and who had only played at one. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so that was Tuesdays. Then it was Wednesdays. You went back to Ortlieb's. You could go to Zanzibar any of those nights. So, you know, and then there was Chris's. Chris's wasn't the Chris's we know now at that time.
Yeah.
It was a little different, but there were still, it was still live music up front. And it was, you know, I'm trying to think of some other places that existed. There were little small places in South Philly, like Night Dreamers. So what bothers me about the scene right now that has become so insular, it's like, and I say this as a challenge, there's the students that go here, that go to Temple University, that graduate, and I have never seen out on the scene, never seen it in a jam session. He never texted me and said, hey, I would like to get into a concert. I don't care if it's me or any other person. It's become like, okay, well, you finish these 4 years in this in these four walls, then you go out into the world, but you were in a city that should have some information for you outside of those walls while you're getting the education in these walls. And you deal with these other institutions that are right here in Philly, and it's nowhere for them to go. So I, you know, and I wasn't trying to bring a dark cloud on. I'm trying to figure out, and that's the beauty of, you know, what was happening at Solar Myth. Just, we need to make an effort. And I had to realize also, I've been saying a lot of times, like, well, the elders had to look in the mirror and be like, well, wait a minute. How old was Mike Boone when I was whatever?
Right.
You know, it's a 20 year difference between Mike and I. So now it's my turn.
Yeah.
You know, now it's everybody needs to step up and really create an environment where the music lives other places than just in the classroom. We need to bring it back to the streets. So Philly has a lot going on, but it's is the jazz scene has been Giuliani'd, and we need to.
that's wild.
I definitely feel you on that, and it's the fixtures that we're missing, right? It's like there's no shortage of appointment viewing, special bookings. You know, we mentioned Solar Myth. I mean, mutual friend of ours, Mark Christman. I mean, shout out to Ars Nova. They've been making special appointment viewing for a long time.
A long time.
But that idea that you can just walk into a space, not even really know who's playing that night, but know that there's something happening.
Yeah.
That I do miss that too.
Yeah. Exactly.
Well, I think too, out of a spirit of necessity over the pandemic, Club Patio, did I get it right? That's what you founded. Would you give a 2 or 3 point starter's guide? If a musician is listening to this, they want to have music, what do they need to have quickly to get a scene happening if we're saying there's actually a shortage of a venue?
Lack of fear.
Mm-hmm.
If you start with that, and you know, there's a motivational book called Go for No. And then, you know, when you read it, you realize that the more you go for no, somewhere on the other side of that, there's a yes. Mm-hmm. You know, today has been one of those no days. I've been on the phone with customer service getting a bunch of no's, but I'm going for yes, and I'm going to make it work.
Yeah.
And if you don't have that in your heart to start with, then just do what feels comfortable for you. If you're talking about a starter kit for the way that I've done it, it's been knock down that door when the rejection comes. Keep going, keep going, keep going. And that's not for everybody. That doesn't, I'm not saying, you know, if someone, I remember someone said to me, I want to do a record, but I got to save some money. Then you don't want to do a record.
That's right.
You know, or I want to do a record. I'm just trying to figure out how to make money when it comes out. Well, you don't want to do a record.
Right.
So if you're not willing to make that commitment to what might not happen and be pleasantly surprised when it does happen, then just do whatever makes you feel comfortable.
Yeah.
And whatever that is up to you. But right that on. That would be, you know, as far as going into this as a business, and when I say that as a business, I mean solely as a performer, you have to be willing to do that. You know, just in the last week, the phone calls I've had and the experiences I've had dealing with major festivals and conversations, nothing negative, but it's not, you don't hang up the phone and say, "Whoo, that was fun."
Right.
You know, it's a whole nother thing. It's like, "Whoo, I got to fill this. Oh, shoot. You know, I didn't give them the right number for my wire transfer. Oh, shoot. I got to cover the band." Like, there's a lot of stuff that people don't think about as an artist and a self-employed leader.
Yeah.
So anybody interested in doing that, that's the first thing I would say. If you're scared of no, do something else.
Well, Orrin, we want to thank you for coming down here to talk to us today, man, and shedding light on your philosophy and helping us to better understand the Philadelphia sound.
And the Philadelphia scene.
Yeah.
And it's going to get better, man.
See, look at you. Look at you. Well, I ain't going nowhere. I'm not going back to New York where my car gets towed. So there it is. Y'all stuck with me. I'm stuck with you.
I like a cosmology where Orrin Evans is in the Council of Elders.
Yeah.
This is the kind of elder that we want.
That's
so onward. Thank you, man.
Thank you for having me.
And thank you for joining us for The Late Set. If you're listening to this after October 25th, WRTI has just dropped a concert film with Orrin Evans and a bunch of Philly cats. It's a super group with Bilal, the vocalist, Evie player, John Swanna, Robin Eubanks, the trombonist, Mike Boone, the bassist, and Justin Faulkner on drums. Wow, you want to see that? It awaits you on our YouTube channel.
And we've got another episode of The Late Set in your podcast feed. This one is an episode with Joshua Redman. We're talking all about competitions. Of course, it features Mr. Bryant and myself. Check him out on the air at WRTI, 90.1 FM in the Philadelphia area. And you can check out what I have to say about the competition and much more at WRTI.org.
The Late Set is a production of WRTI and made possible by WRTI members. It's hosted by yours truly, Greg Bryant and Nate Chinen. The show is produced by Alex Arif.
WRTI's operations manager is Joe Patti, and director of production is Tyler McClure. Associate general manager for content and programming is Josh Jackson. Bill Johnson is WRTI's general manager. Our website, thelateset.org. While you're there, you can see everything else WRTI has cooking here in Philadelphia and beyond. We'll see you soon.